Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.
Hi, my name is Barb Emmet. Thank you for joining us on the show Dog is Family, where we celebrate the bond between people and their dogs, where we explore all parts of their lifestyle and keep them happy in their mind, body, and their spirit. I will be your host for this next hour. I'm also the proprietor of Godfrey's Welcome to Dogdom, a place where we just love and celebrate our dogs. There's a lot of information in our show today, so I hope you get your paper and pencils ready. I say this every month because we are packed with good stuff today. And so first of all, I'd like to just do a brief intro that to let you know what's going on for this next hour. In the first half hour, we're going to be exploring a very exciting science of understanding more about your dog by learning about their fur and what it can tell us. And coinciding with that then is learning about how to take care of their fur and coats. And I've invited Cindy Blatt, professional groomer. Hi, Cindy.
Hello, how are you?
I'm fabulous, and I'm so excited that you joined us. Our series starts with grooming do-it-yourself, DIY. It's happening in every industry, and boy, if you took the approach of DIY, you'd be helping your dog and your groomers. And Cindy's gonna be sharing why the brushes and combs and the tools that you're using to prepare your dog for grooming will make it all better in the end. So stay tuned. Cindy will be on in the second half hour, but we're going to get started right away. We are Skyping guests from Atlanta. Let me just give you a brief intro. I am very lucky when I pursue my passion with dogs and our lifestyles with them to attend trade shows and expos and do a lot of reading and do a lot of research about dogs and products and services so that we can keep up with it and do the best selection that we can. So at the last show I was at recently, I met these two young, wonderful folks who are in a new science area. And the company that they represent is Five Strands Affordable Pet Testing. So let me introduce these guests from Atlanta on Skype. We have Austin Collins, who is a co-founder, and Melissa Blaurock, who is the branding manager for Five Strands Affordable Pet Testing. Let's go to them in Skype. Hi, guys.
Hey.
Hello, Barb. Hey. How are you doing today?
Good. How is it down there in Atlanta?
Very good, very good.
And do you have some other guests with you? Puppies?
Yes, we have my dog Lily.
She's Hi, Lily.
The Skype camera.
And my new adopted dog, as of 5 days ago, is sitting at my feet, and he won't leave my side right now.
Excellent. I'm happy for both of you to have puppies there to share with us today.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's just a thrill. I have been helping dogs for years with nutrition and better selection. And when I talked to you folks at this expo, I became very excited. Perhaps we can show a video briefly introducing them to Five Strands Affordable Pet Testing, and then I'd love to turn it over to you both to give us more of an idea of what's going on. And then the exciting part as well is that I sent my Golden Retriever Lakes hair samples to you for analysis, and we're going to share with the folks what I learned and what people can learn from this testing. So let's show that video, and then you guys, we're going to get into it. What is new and exciting here?
Great, Barb.
You're doing great.
Now, I know all of you watching today with dogs are very excited about what you just saw. And you know the theory and the philosophy we have at Dog is Family, which is to put the power of care into you, the pet parents, to be proactive, to be involved in your dog's health, and not to simply accept what may be told to you in your world, just like for our children, for our families. Dogs are our family. This is a proactive approach for you to start to learn more and do more and do differently. So on that note, Austin and Melissa, take it away and introduce us to the company and what's going on here.
Well, hello guys. So my name is Austin, sitting with me is Melissa. We represent Five Strands Affordable Pet Testing. What we do here is a non-invasive testing procedure that's done through a hair analysis in order to determine your food intolerances and environmental sensitivities that your pet may have. So we test for raw foods, cooked foods, preservatives, and we also test for the environmental stress factors that can be weeds, pollens, grasses, trees, and fabrics that may be in their home, causing some of the common symptoms you may be seeing your pet exemplify. These maybe represent hot spots, an upset stomach, excessive hair loss. Our pets try and communicate with us by showing these stress factors, and our testing procedure helps find the underlying issues of what may be the probable cause of these issues.
Excellent. What I was very interested in is seeing that you are testing foods and environmental. I know up until this point, some of the allergy testing the veterinarians do use, I see Spot for one. Some others are focused on foods. You are doing so many items. How did all of this come about, first of all, for our pets?
So we actually started our testing on the human side of things. And as we were on the human side of things, we went to trade shows much like yourself. And we ended up falling in the hands of a couple of puppy lovers, as we're all pet owners ourselves in office. And we kind of just learned that this is a much needed market. And, you know, we were stressed out ourselves with providing or paying a lot of money, I guess, for information that didn't exactly cause or solve the issue that we needed it to. So we kind of took action. We critiqued the science and testing a little bit. And from that point, we've been able to build case studies of just a number and countless amount of dogs that, I mean, we've helped, and relationships we've helped bonded back together.
Excellent. So this, I'm sorry, Melissa, do you have something you wanted to add there?
My mom, actually, she founded the company with Austin and another one of the co-founders, Ethan. They pretty much just pushed her, saying, you need to do something with this. We want to help you. And that's kind of how everything came together. We all grew up together, which is really nice that we all balance each other out in the office.
Excellent. Because then the science was there for the human side. So then it was applying it for our pets.
Yes.
Correct.
Very exciting. Do you have a brief little, any kind of case study, Austin or Melissa, that you want to share? It just a quick story, and then we'll get into some of the specifics of it. But dogs you've helped.
We have a good bit.
Yeah, we've got a couple to choose from, but I would say one of our best ones is we had a dog a couple months back who had bleeding paws. They were so stressed out that they were nibbling and just spreading blood throughout the entire house on the carpet. Hmm. And the person didn't know what the issue was, and then ran our test and found out that they had an intolerance to wool. So the owner actually ripped out all the carpet, and the dog stopped with the stress factors, removed the problem, and from that point on, they healed in less than a week.
Wow, that's really powerful.
And you know, we try and make that, I guess, as prevalent as we can, showing that, look, this is a severe case, but, you know, there's other people that had issues like digestive issues, and we've had dogs that, you know, build the hot spots. We had one last week that, you know, had a full raw diet, but some of the foods that were being consumed were stressing them out, and there was no way for a common vet allergy test to determine it. So they took the food intolerance test, found a couple of foods that they were actually feeding them, removed it, and then their digestive issues went away at the end of the day as well.
Beautiful. That's what we're looking for, just improving the health in the best ways we can. And we always have stressed, too, that the health starts in the gut. You know, it starts in that immune system, and when the dogs are hot, things are blown out of control. And it's that whole analysis of trying to figure it out. I don't know, maybe you have a response to this. I do know locally, in many cases, we'll hear people trying to get help with it, perhaps at their veterinarians or somewhere where then they're quickly put on a allergy medication. And I don't, you know, there's times when I think we could do a longer, tougher job of trying to do the analysis of what's really going on. Any case studies about that, perhaps?
Would you like to share the one about Aquaquil, the one across the street?
Okay, yeah. So we have an office across the street that their dog was put on Aquaquil, and we were like, hey, well, why don't you try our test out, see if it can help? So they tried our test out, and what, just a few days later, they were completely off of all of their medications that the vet had prescribed to them.
Right. So they did identify some...
Correct. Mm-hmm. I mean, the vet, you know, puts these dogs on Aquaquil, and it's just a topical. You know, it's not going to actually solve the root of the problem. And we understand that nutrition, you know, makes up, I mean, a good majority of these issues. So by kind of determining these problems, we actually helped the underlying issues at hand and removed the need for the Aquaquil.
That's excellent. I'm very excited to hear that. And again, it's another tool. Any other case studies before we jump into the data? I come from data, so for me, this was very exciting to look at my dog's test and discuss some of the things that I learned about my dog, Lake. Any other case study before we move on, you two?
One more, just because it just happened. So my dog that I just adopted, the reason why I adopted it is it came from a kill shelter, and I had a previous friend that was owning it, said that it was shedding too much. It started to have dander issues, so she was going to return it. And yeah. I said, well, let me, you know, run a test on it. Let me try and fix its diet some. I've had him for 5 days now, and I've started to switch up his diet. His fur is now lush. He's not shedding as much, and the dander has been removed. So, you know, for us, that's why we started the company, trying to help the sheltered dogs. We really want to partner with them and being able to, you know, just make sure that everybody finds a home and they don't get returned where they came from.
Excellent. Yeah, keep them in their forever homes once they find a home, right? Make life the best it can be. And you're coming at it with that passion, which I think speaks a lot to that. That's exciting. And congratulations again for your adoption, Austin. When I looked at the list of pet food ingredients tested, and I believe you said how many pet food? Is it 200 ingredients?
200 ingredients, yes.
Okay. And then the environmental testing, there's quite a few of those that are found in our area. I guess that was another question I had. In different areas, say the Midwest versus the East Coast, West Coast, you look like you're really covering pretty much the gamut, at least for our area. Is that correct, our country? Or how do you look at that environmental panel? I know it's new, but I mean, it's a lot you're covering.
We built our items tested kind of based on North America. So a lot of the items are spread out to kind of appeal throughout the entire North America region.
Okay, thank you for that. Thank you. I'll just read folks a few of these things. We don't have a list that we can actually show them. Do you think it's better to do that, guys, or should we get right into our My Lake's results and discuss that as a live discussion? What would you prefer?
Let's jump into Lake's results, and then we can add on any additional information we need to from there.
Yeah, let me tell you, part of the process, folks, if you do go this path to learning more on your own, they are there to talk with you on the phone to review the results as well, because you're going to get them like I even did. And I've been doing nutrition naturally for almost 20 years and helping folks with tweaks and changes and adjustments. And even for me, when I first looked at it, there were a lot of questions. So just know their support will be there as well. As we also learn on our end here, more how to look at that and what that may be telling you. As you know, data is only so good as your ability to interpret it. So, okay, Austin, I'll get started. And I want to say first off, like for me, I felt pretty comforted by Lake's list. There wasn't a whole lot screaming at me. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I would say that his list looks very well compared to some of the lists that we get.
Yeah.
You know, the main thing, you see a couple proteins on the list, such as turkey and tuna, But then the good information or the good news is that there's only two preservatives that are in there. And a lot of people will write their intolerances off as, you know, just being the whole food itself. And sometimes when we feed our dogs kibble food or wet food, some of the preservatives that are placed in it are actually the issue at hand. So for you, it's very easy to follow and very, very nice, clean report. I will say that.
Yeah, right, Melissa? Right, yeah.
Yeah, so the preservatives that he's talking about are the E items that mm-hmm. we see on the test results.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And Lake, the folks that are viewing here today, Lake is on an Answers raw diet, which is phenomenal, and eats a lot of the other raw products that they use. So what I've learned, because turkey came up high, and that's one of four meat rotations in his diet right now. We rotate between beef, turkey, pork, and chicken. We sometimes use rabbit occasionally and a white fish occasionally. So for the turkey now, for me, I will be using it, but I will not be using it as much as I may in a month's diet because he has no issues. So this taught me, like, okay, well, we'll maybe shift a little bit more to the beef and the pork and the chicken. Makes sense, right?
Yeah, so the report, you know, is broken down into three levels. This helps explain kind of the severity of each one and how, if exposed to in large quantity, where the issues may lie in some of the common symptoms.
Yeah.
So, you know, we send everybody a report on how to interpret the test results for themselves. But like you said earlier, we're always here to answer questions and help aid anything we can possibly.
Yeah. So you had said to me as well, like if it was a very high reaction, people might be seeing hot spots or nibbling at paws. I have none of that. But it would help then when people start talking about issues to say, oh, my dog has hot spots, and they continue to have nibbling at paws, then that's that high red level typically. Is that correct, would you say, the level threes?
Yeah, so level one reports are usually something very, very minor, like a wet nose or maybe sneezing as a reaction. The level twos kind of progress into the itching, possibly starting to, you know, lick their paws constantly. And then once when you move into the level three, that's where you see the upset stomach, the hot spots. You know, you start to see a lot more of the severe issues that have just built up and progressed.
Yeah, so he really looked clean. So, of course, with the diet he has and how he's been very, very healthy, I've been happy about that. And I know, you know, green was level one, a banana, and every now and then we'll give him a piece of banana and carrot, and that's all fine in moderation with what he's doing. Do you see anything else on his food allergy testing you think I should talk about?
When they overlap.
Yeah, the only other question that some people have is whenever you see a food item show up on multiple levels. And whenever you see them on multiple levels, this is usually a staple issue that you should definitely avoid.
Okay.
Your pet's going to show these symptoms from not only, you know, the highest level, but those lower levels as well. And those are going to result in the high stress factors.
And Lake, the only thing I saw there was sweet potato. So.
Yes, yeah, sweet potato, that. And I think there's also raspberries on there and shiitake mushrooms.
Oh, yeah, raspberries, shiitake mushrooms, and raspberries. Good, thank you for pointing that one out. We don't usually give him shiitake, but raspberries every now and then he might have. let's see, and then we talked about the difference between fermented raw goat's milk and goat's milk because he's definitely on the fermented products, and mm-hmm. none of that shows up, but you do test for goat's milk, correct?
Yes, we do.
Good. So should we look at environmental then?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so for pet environmental items tested, and I can read this list, folks. I'm just telling you things like cherry trees, cats, canaries, buttercups, aspergillus, balsam fir, aspens, clover, crabgrass, dandelion, dogwood, Douglas fir. So when we look at Lake again, I mean, there's so many items here. And I saw in our area, they're definitely on there. Oh, he is showing. Oh, here he was. Wait, I'm getting to him and I don't see him. I know that some moldy. Do you have Lakes there?
Yes, I do.
We have it in front of you.
Oh, yeah, here it is. Okay, I got it now. I'm looking at so much here. There it is. Got it. Okay. He had mold 1 allergy as a level 3, which is high. Help us understand mold 1, mold 2, and mold 3.
So we actually have a mold specialist on staff to be able to speak about this stuff, but through the education of having her here, we've learned that mold one that showed up on his report is due to it growing on fruits and vegetables, and that's how we identify it. And then we've also testing for mold two, which is on household material items. Okay. So Blake was showing up for mold one, which just shows that he's sensitive to maybe fruits and vegetables that could be starting to age a little heavily.
That's so interesting. And then he had Aspergillus fumigatus, another mold, right? Spore forming. Okay. We talked about that the other day. And then I thought an interesting one at his level two was pine. Now, you mentioned something interesting about pine sensitivity. Tell us that.
Okay, so we had another case study. We had a dog that was being very stressed out, and the parent didn't exactly know why, and she had cleaned her house with pine.
Oh, that's right.
And once, when she got her test results back, pine was level three, and she was thinking of pine trees. And now, you know, we test for environmental items, but you got to remember that cotton is tested for. That can make up dogs' bedding, clothing that you have them on. So it also makes up cleaning materials, and the pine was an issue. So she felt really bad. She called in crying, and she's like, you know, I'm sorry. And I was like, you don't have to apologize to us. I said, we just are hoping that, you know, now you don't use this anymore, yeah, and your dog is a little happier and less stressed out.
She didn't know before, and now she does because she tried our test. So
yeah. And I wasn't thinking
dog because of that.
I wasn't thinking that way either myself personally when I saw pine. And then when Austin and I chatted through it, it was like, oh my goodness. So it could be the pine cleaning. It could be this. It could be, you know, a toy that has something stuffed with pine.
A pine-scented candle.
Yeah, a candle even perhaps.
Yeah.
Is that true? An essential oil? I guess if it's in its purest form, it would be a true pine. Yeah. That would make sense.
Yeah.
And duck feathers, again.
Yeah.
I'm thinking he's not out looking at ducks. There's nowhere else he's going to see ducks, but...
But they're in a lot of pillowcases, especially if you travel a lot. There's a lot of duck feathers in hotels.
True. Very true.
Yep.
So he has that, and he has clover, and we don't put any weed killers on our grass, so I that could happen for him, but that was a low.
Right.
Christmas trees in the house made me wonder about the pine level. Any comment on that? Because we're a lot of big Christmas tree folks up here where we raise Christmas trees and use them in our homes at the holiday. Would that be an issue?
It can sometimes be an issue. The main thing that I would just recommend is putting it in an area of the house that maybe the dog bed is not in, kind of separating them so that way they're not constantly... being exposed to that.
Perfect. I think what also I'd like to talk about is how easy this was for me to do. All I had to do, they talk about it being 5 strands of fur. All I had to do was rake it once. I just took it because I wanted to grab it closest to the skin, guys. Isn't that correct?
Yes.
And I, you know, I wanted, right? And I just put it in a bag and mailed it off. And with their labs, the results were quick for us for the show to share with you, but honestly, how long do you say the turnaround time is?
It's roughly 5-day turnaround time once when it reaches our processing center.
Excellent. And would you consider this like new technology, biotechnology, and are you revising it as we go, or, you know, it's new. I hope people start to think about it, but what would you say going forward with the business and how you feel about it?
I would say the technology has been around for a little while, but we've really started to meet this trend of where people are starting to empower themselves. And, you know, for us, it's just trying to shed some light and some exposure on it. So, you know, we started this just to start helping people who are close to us, and now we're just trying to share it with as many people who are willing to listen.
Excellent. Stay out of the vet's office. Take care of your dog. Work with people. I know we specialize in nutrition counseling at Godfrey's. There are other folks that do that. There are integrative veterinarians, and some of your veterinarians you can consult with, certainly, that are really ready to look at all of those things. I think it's a wonderful start and power to the people as pet parents. So thank you. Is there any leading thoughts you might have? We'll show your contact information. I will be having some of these kits at Godfrey's.
Yes.
And working, I can work with you as well to interpret some of those results, but I'm learning from them as well. So any final thoughts before you put up your contact sheet, Austin?
It's great for a Christmas present.
Hey, that's a great idea. Yeah, it's a great idea. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. You care about your granddog, your dogs. Wow, it's a lot that you can learn.
We would just like to say thank you for having us on your show, and we appreciate, you know, you taking the time out to do this for us.
You are so welcome. It's a passion of mine, as it's a passion of yours, to help dogs stay healthy and get better and well and enjoy life to the fullest. So we're on the same page there. Thank you for both coming on from Atlanta. And we'll put that contact information up again, folks. And thanks again.
Thanks,
absolutely.
Barb. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, so we'll take a little break. Ready to move in? Hey folks, thanks for staying with us. That was a very exciting segment. Some folks have asked about the cost of the kit. Is now around $140 for the hair analysis kit. So stay tuned on that. I hope you enjoyed that. Our next segment now, since we've been talking about fur analysis, is to get into grooming. And for my guest, of course, I have Cindy Blatt. And let me read you a nice bio about Cindy. Finally, I got to meet Cindy. I'd heard a lot about her. And this show allows me that opportunity to reach out and meet some wonderful folks that are taking care of our dogs. Cindy has Cindy's Canine Companion Salon and Services, which she started in 1995. After seeing the need in the community, as well as seeing how easily we could modify simple beauty treatments to benefit our pets, Cindy graduated from the James School of Pet Grooming in 1997, so it's been some time with this. She was in a veterinary assistant training program, Reading Area Community College in 2006, and a Penn Foster Career School in 2006. When she has many international certifications, you've reported, and regularly attends conferences. Cindy is always learning. I can tell she's a perpetual learner, even though she's a professional in this field for years. And actually, she's a well-known grooming trainer. Folks come from all over to attend with Cindy one-on-one to learn what to do and how to do it correctly. There's a lot of levels of quality out there. So I am going to turn it over to Cindy, and she's going to stay with her, because what I find, again, in the store, people don't know what brush or comb to use for a certain coat, and quite frankly, we struggle with that. Double mat, single coat, double coat, what tool? Here you go. I'm turning it over to Cindy.
Thank you, Barb, for having me today.
You're welcome.
I'm excited to share a little bit of information. Today I brought my little friendly dog. I'm going to name her Angel today.
Okay, she's Angel.
But let's just go back a little bit. You just got your first pet, and you want to bond with your pet and have some quality time. She hasn't been to a groomer yet because she has she's young, or she's new to your home if she was a rescue. And so we want to brush her and comb her and just have that nice quality bonding time with her. But what brush do you use? What tool? What equipment? A lot of people, when they pick up their dogs, whether it be from a specialized breeder or a rescue, they don't cover that information. So what do we use? You go to a store and there's thousands of brushes and combs to pick from. And so the first thing we need to do is kind of analyze the coat of your pet. Dogs come with lots of fun different kinds of coats. This dog would be considered probably close to a single-coated dog, maybe a little bit of curly coat. Might be a mix. We're not quite sure what Angel is. But there's lots of different types of coats we have. We have single-coated dogs. What that means is they have very little tiny shed. All dogs shed. I know people say, you know, if you buy a poodle or you buy a shih tzu, they do not shed, but they're like humans. We all shed a little bit. So that being said, that's one type of coat. They basically call those dogs hypoallergenic. We also see double-coated dogs. That might be your German Shepherds. It might be your Shelties. There's any dog that will basically shed. And there's rough double-coated. Those are dogs like your quiche hounds and collies that are really thick and dense underneath. And we have those. And then we have our smooth-coated dogs, which will be like your Cocker Spaniels that are smooth on top and they get into a little bit thicker on the bottom. It could be your Dachshunds. You could be your Coonhounds, anything with a very short type of hair on top. Still sheds a little bit, but not as much. So there's different brushes that we can use and curries for each of those different types of coats. The other thing that is really beneficial for your pet, and is actually will be very helpful and healthy for your pet, when we comb or brush our pets, it brings the natural oils to the top of the coat. And when you have that, you get that nice, shiny, glossy look. And it also helps to get rid of all the dead cells and pushes that out the side. For groomers, we like to see a nice shiny coat. Now, what I'm talking about today isn't something, I'm not teaching you how to groom your dog. I'm teaching you how to maintain your dog between grooming appointments. It's very, very important that you continue to get your dog groomed, because your groomer will look at not just the coat, the skin. She will pick up he will pick up different issues that your dog may be having. So this is in conjunction with good grooming. And I think that's really, really important to talk about. So what I'm going to do is go into some of the different tools that we have.
Why? Because that's the questions we'll get. My dog has this double coat. I really like this brush. You know, should I use it? Well, let's talk about that. And, you know, that's, you know, we're nutrition, we're play, we're all kinds of things. But when it comes to these brushes and combs, it gets a little confusing. And I hate to see people waste money on things they don't need or they won't use or that could hurt their dog.
Now, at the very least, all you really, really need is a good brush and a good comb. At the very least.
Just like one brush and one comb?
Yes, and that is it. However, for the different types of coats, so we don't hurt the coat in any way or break the coat, there's lots of fun things that we can use to make it much more enjoyable for the dog.
Okay.
And this, you do want to have this bonding time with your pet. And the more you can do at home, the nicer it's going to be for that dog when she meets the groomer. So let's start with slicker brushes.
Okay.
We have lots of fun different types of brushes we can use. A slicker brush has really fine short wires that are side by side. And this will help pull out dead coat. It also helps pull out tiny little pin mats. And it will reach down pretty far deep into the coat, depending on the different coats. You can use a slicker brush. I tend to use it on wired coats, on double coats, curly coats, pretty much any kind of coat. The difference with this is you want to be careful about going deep into the skin, because it can also scratch the skin.
Yeah, that's where I would get worried. you said it could be, your chart is talking about Goldens, Yorkshire Terriers, Cockers.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Spaniels, Poodles, but it always says, always be gentle with them.
Yeah, see, that's
always
where...
be very gentle. Now, along the same lines, which is really fun, is this is a different type of slicker brush. And this brush has nice little white pins on it. And this will actually, if you do touch the skin, it's not going to scratch.
Bends more or something.
It bends, it gives, and it doesn't scratch.
But it still is doing the job you think of
how that
slicker brush works.
Yes.
Good.
And it
okay.
works really, really well.
Now, so, would that be a good one for, you have a golden doodle, I understand,
mm-hmm,
right?
I do. Yes, I have two.
Mm-hmm. Oh, two. Is that the kind of...
I will tend to use this on my one golden doodle who tends to have a thinner coat.
Uh-huh.
Because I really want to get in there and get the little tiny mats out without scratching her. For Lucy, who's a thicker standard doodle, I will tend to use this brush.
Okay.
And I'm just careful about how much pressure I put. I think if you're gentle, you won't scratch the dogs.
Okay.
So I will use
those.
Thank
you.
Mm-hmm. The bristle brush, which is this little guy here, very nice and soft. Probably out of all the brushes, this is probably your most least effective.
Yeah, okay.
It just kind of goes on top of the skin. It doesn't do a whole lot. It's used for mostly very, very smooth-coated dogs. It will pick up debris like dirt and dandruff, but it isn't really effective as far as taking mats out or... bringing the natural oils up to the top of the skin.
A lot of times they'll
do a nice brush.
The design with that on one side and a pin with the other side.
And this has the pin, and that's why we bring this, we usually typically buy these brushes because you can do two different things with it. The pin brush on here, and let me see, do I have pins on here?
Yeah,
It actually does look very much similar to what we use at home.
Yeah,
and it's very much, it will get deeper down into the coat. It's more for the long-coated, that's what I use it for like long-coated Shih Tzus, Afghan Hounds, Collies, any of your long-haired breeds, Yorkies, they're great because they don't rip the hair, and it helps maintain their coats. And then if you just want to follow up with a really nice smooth.
Then use that side.
It is nice, yeah. It's really good.
Okay.
So we'll use that one.
Shelties, Collies, Afghans.
The rubber curry.
Oh, yeah.
This is fun, too. I like. This is, again, for smooth-coated dogs, your short dogs, your doxies, hound dogs, Weimannheimers, Dalmatians, Rottweilers, Doberman Pinschers. What this does is this will loosen up dead hair, because even though they are very smooth-coated, they do shed. And... by using this and using it in a reversed motion, it will pull out the dead hair. Hmm. And I tend to use this when I'm have the dogs in the bath.
Okay.
And it alleviates a lot of the dirt in the home. But what's really nice is when you're sitting watching TV with your pet. This is like getting a massage.
Oh, it would be.
It is. It feels very, very nice. Your dogs love this.
Light touch.
It also gets the dogs, again, ready to be groomed and getting used to their coat being touched. So this is a great all-around tool for any dog. And I love this.
Is it any coat?
You
just
like
it.
You can do this with any coat.
Any coat.
Now, if I'm using it on a straight hair or a curly, I'm just going to brush down with it.
Straight. You're not going
to
curl
it. Because I don't want a mat, but it is a nice comb to use for any breed. But this is especially good in what I use for all smooth coats. Okay. Let's see what else we have here. Mat breakers. This is a mat breaker.
Ooh, we hope we don't have them, but we do, right?
Yes, yes. And if our people tend to go a little longer between groomings, occasionally if you have a longer haired dog, you're going to get a mat. A mat breaker is made up of little blades, tiny little blades that if I put my finger in there, I'm going to bleed.
Okay.
They're real blades. And what its job is to do is to help you go through the coat. I'm going to just demonstrate this quick.
Yeah, please do.
If I find a mat in the dog's coat here, I'm going to just go through the mat like this.
Quick
and easy, and I'm going to demat this dog right in front of us here.
Aww.
And what that does, and then after I do that, I'm going to take a comb and comb through the mat. And that will pull out our mat, okay?
Mat breaker.
It's called a mat breaker. I can use this on a dog that might have a few mats. I'm not going to do this to a dog that's severely matted. If a dog comes in severely matted, we're going to shave him down. Yeah. So to my owners out there, if your dog is severely matted, please don't be upset with your groomer when she has to shave it. It's really for the benefit of your dog,
yeah,
so that we don't harm your dog in any way. A few mats, we use the mat breaker. It works wonders. And I usually advise my homeowners, my owners and my pets, to if they have a dog that they want to keep longer, to invest in a mat breaker, because guaranteed between sessions they're going to get mats, especially if they let their dogs be dogs and run and play and be outside and enjoy, you know, being a pet. So this tool is very, very important to have.
So you have the blade on one side and then the brushing. So it's a two-step kind of process usually.
I just pull through.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and golden retrievers, as you know, I'm all golden retriever mama here, sometimes behind their ears.
Behind their ears, in their chest.
In their chest.
In the thigh, rear end area, anywhere where the hair is long, could be matted from being running around, being outside, or when they're self-cleaning.
It's
they can create
tool.
Their own mats. So that's another tool we have. Let me turn this here.
You want me to hold?
There we go. We're good. Let's see what else we have here. Rakes.
Yeah.
These little guys. These are fun too. They're designed to go through really, really thick coats. And it works. And a lot of these pins will actually twist so it can maneuver down into the coat. And when we do
that,
it will take out a lot of the undercoat, because that's what we want to get rid of. We want to get rid of the deep coat that's underneath that tends to get matted when it drops. It starts to drop out. Every dog has two really major shed times a year. And if we don't get that coat out, as the new hair comes in, it mats. So this will help penetrate and get deep into the coat. You're looking at Huskies, Malamutes, Pomeranians, even our cute little Poms that are really, really fluffy collies underneath. This will help pull that out.
Now, you said they twist. I don't know that I've seen one
that
twist.
Some of them twist and turn. Now, these don't, but a lot of my new ones do. They twist. And it really helps work through the coat, helps not to rip the coat.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
really important that we maintain the integrity of the dog's coat.
Yeah, because if people overuse that, they could really harm that coat.
Yes, yes.
So you have to be cautious.
You got to be cautious with that. We talked about the pin brush. Combs. Now, combs to me are a big part of grooming. It's not enough to just brush your coat, because what I found is my clients will come in and they'll say, oh, Cindy, I brush my dog every day. And they do. And this dog comes in and it's all fluffy and beautiful. However, when I take a comb through it, I can't penetrate anything underneath.
Is that right?
That nice, beautiful fluff on top.
Okay.
Because what happens is a dog will mat from the skin out most of the time.
Wow.
So they brush and they're brushing and it looks so beautiful on the top, and they really are trying. But when I take the comb through and do the comb test, that's where I find all the matting.
Have you ever seen a comb with that width in there?
These
that's
are great
nice.
For poodles that have a really
nice.
Curly coat.
Yeah.
And I love a comb after I do a poodle. So I'm going to show you a little bit about, and combs are good for any coat. You can use them for your rough coats, your smooth coats, your cockers, your poodles, pretty much any dog. We also have up here, this is another kind of rake, and I did bring it right here.
Oh, yeah.
This is a fun rake. This has little blades all over it.
Yeah.
My husband calls these torture.
Yeah, you better know what you're doing with this.
You better know what this is. You don't put your fingers in this, you'll bleed. So, but this goes alongside of the rake that I had in here somewhere. I don't know where I put it now.
There, in the front, the purple one?
Yeah, there it is. It helps pull out a lot of dead hair. If I have, like, your golden retriever, and they're really thick in the neck, I can go like this and trim that all out and get this laying nice and smooth.
Yes.
And it pulls it out without hurting the dog.
Wow.
It makes a mess in your house, or in your station, but it will not hurt your dog. And if you use this, it will help thin out an area, and it's also can be used to break out mats as well.
Okay.
Okay. So we use that. So these are the basic tools that I typically will use to groom a dog in the salon, or I recommend my owners. Now, if I'm going to teach a little bit about how I want my owners
yes.
to do it, the most important thing is we need to get down into the coat. It's not enough to just brush this dog, sir, on the surface.
Okay.
Because there's times when they do that and they come in, and if I feel the dog and it's very condensed, that means it's matted down close to the skin.
And people may not even realize that?
Oh, no, they don't. And it's sad because they really think they're doing a great job, and they really are.
They're doing it.
But they're doing it.
Not getting
they're just
down.
Not getting deep enough.
Letting that coat breathe.
Yes. And it's not an issue with, your, of course, your smooth-coated dogs. But when you have a thick-coated dog or a long-haired dog, we're going to teach you how to do a little bit of what we call line brushing. And line brushing helps you to get down deep into the coat. And it's kind of fun. So if I'm going to do a line brushing, I'm going to use my slicker brush. And I am going to start on the hips, because the hip of a dog has a lot of hair that is usually very bulky and falls out when we're doing a lot of deshedding. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull the hair up all the way to the skin, okay? And depending on where I want to start, I may start on the neck, I may start in the rear, and I'm going to start brushing at the base of that, like this, and get that hair. And once I get that smooth and brushed out, and I'm going right to the skin, I'm going to,
got it okay.
Let me just get this down here. There you go. I'm going to go and I'm going to bring a little bit more hair down, just enough, and I'm going to keep brushing that out. And what helps is it alleviates the matting, too, if I can get down to the skin. Then I'm going to brush that down, and I'm going to do some more. And I'm going to keep doing this all the way through the whole coat on a double-coated dog. And then I know that I am getting every part. Once my owners are done with that, then I tell them to take their comb and go through the whole coat.
Okay.
Their comb should be able to touch the skin and go
right
down and through it. And
okay.
if they can do that, then they know that they don't have any mats. If they run into a mat, if they have a mat breaker, pop that out, and then they can comb it the rest of the way. But they should be able to go right through, like this is going right through to that dog's skin and all the way down. And now that's clear.
Excellent.
So he has a really nice smooth hip there. And then I would do that all the way through.
So this is what groomers are doing, folks, when you're thinking, why are they there that long?
Our house.
This is what happens when professional groomers are working with your dog.
And then when they're all done, they can do a little misting. And then they smell good between sessions. Because no one likes that doggy dog smell.
Nobody does.
So I recommend a brush, a comb, a mat breaker, and a little cologne. And I think that's going to help them look good and, you know, feel good.
Awesome.
So
I have a few tools. Take us through some of these, perhaps. This is some things that we have at the store. And here now I know I'm doing a pin brush without the other side.
Yeah, that's good.
The comb, here's a comb that I get a little confused about.
That is what we call a flea comb. This is really, really great if you have any thoughts that your dog might have fleas. Now, hopefully you're going to your great pet store and picking up a good preventative.
Mm-hmm.
All dogs should be on a good preventative. Mm-hmm. However, if you do have an issue with fleas, this little comb is great for pulling them out.
Through.
So that is a great little tool.
They don't call it.
I think you also have, this
fine
here is
tooth.
A nice.
Fine tooth.
Yep. And this is really, really a nice tool to use because this is great. It has no sharp edges. I love that. These are really fun. And this is great for your smooth-coated dogs. This is going to pull out a lot of dead hair. So this is another tool that you can use sitting in your living room and just kind of chilling out with your dog.
And the fun thing
on that one,
I know, you just push this little, I know you folks probably can't see it, but you can just slide this and it releases the fur. So you're not even getting involved in pulling a lot. It will release it right from this.
That's what I like about my slicker brush, too.
Okay.
You can push that in.
It just comes right out.
Because those little pins can hurt.
Different ones, and they're trying to help folks, like 45 pounds and over, but it's not based on the type of fur. So that's where we still need a little help. Yeah, they're just doing it by size. No sharp edges. Mm-hmm. Won't scratch or pull. Now, that kind of brush actually has attachments you can buy.
Yeah, you can do all kinds of fun things. That's really convenient for a homeowner. This kind of thing here,
right?
That you can attach combs, brushes. It's one tool fits all.
Yeah.
And I think for a homeowner, that is a great tool to have.
I was attracted by it, but I needed to hear a professional groomer say why they
would like them. I think it's a great tool.
And then here's another wet or dry. Oh, that's a good point. Like using these things wet or dry?
I am a proponent for dry at home, wet in the grooming salon. We tend to do a lot of our de-shedding in the tub with our dogs, but I think if you take a good slicker brush and use it regularly, daily, you're going to alleviate 80% of your dead hair all over your house. Who doesn't want that?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I know.
You know, people don't. You know, they really are tired of tumbleweeds.
Yes, so definitely.
This is a great tool to use.
Okay,
and that's wonderful.
Well, the nail clipping is another topic. Yep. We're not getting into that. I'm checking for what else I may have in the grab bag of products.
No, you have a lot of fun stuff.
I try to make it practical.
Every groomer,
and
this is like Christmas, going and seeing all this kind of stuff. We
and
love
you'll
this.
Notice that Cindy loves what she does.
Everything
she's doing is saying, this is fun. Mm-hmm. So this is someone that truly loves what she's doing.
Do.
And again, this one's just a little different, rounded.
Well, the nice thing about this has an ergonomic handle.
Oh, yeah.
Your hand's going to get tired. You have a big old newfie at home.
Yeah.
You're going to get tired.
Yeah.
Having a good gripping handle is really, really important, too. Way different than having, this comb. This is a harder handle to have.
Yeah.
Or even my brush here. This is tough, but having an ergonomically correct tool to use is going to make it much nicer and more enjoyable with your pet.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
So I guess we've gotten through most of the tools. She's been a wonderful model for us today.
Yeah, she has. She's good. My students love using this dog.
If anybody would like, I know I have a copy of Cindy's poster here, and you can certainly email when we show our contact information at the end to get all his family. The address, I will certainly get some things out to you. I think that's a very helpful informational poster. I hope you folks are understanding that and seeing how you can work with your dog quietly, calmly, a little bit every day to keep them ready to go to the groomer. So we don't want to turn them over to groomers and have all kinds of issues. We want them to be good all the way through, right, Cindy?
Right. You can actually save money.
There you go.
This is a good part. You can save money by having your pet properly prepared. If you are brushing and combing, it's going to be less matting for the groomer to have to take care of, less time that the groomer has to spend. And also, it makes your pet a lot nicer and easier for the groomer to work with because the dog's used to having somebody's hands on, preferably their owner's, working with the dog.
Yeah.
And that just makes for a wonderful experience all the way around for the owner and for the dog and for the groomer.
Excellent, excellent tips. That's so good. Anybody have any call-ins? We have a few minutes. I can also give you Cindy's contact information if you have any questions. She's a very busy lady. But if you'd like to give them your phone number, go right ahead.
You can reach me at 717-933-1333. And I'm pretty much available anytime. I will. That number is right there in my home office, so I can answer any questions that you may have or concerns, or if you're not sure of something with your pet, I'll gladly help and answer.
Isn't that nice to hear? That's excellent. Thank you so much for the viewers for
offering. Thank you for having me. This was fun.
I knew you were going to say that. I said to her, "You're going to have a good time. You're going to want to come back and talk about nail
maintenance." And I love talking about this stuff.
This is your passion. Wonderful.
I love it.
And I think people need to stay up on that.
Yeah.
So hopefully, you viewers got a lot out of it. And just as a sidebar, Cindy has I forgot to bring my calming products while they're going to the groomer. Cindy has one, an aromatherapy product, and also a grooming table that we have
built grooming tables. I've done aromatherapy blends. I usually buy my oils from all over the world, and I do my own blending for calming dogs.
Nice.
And
that
works
helps,
really
right?
Nice. Yep. And we have the grooming course at our school, and that works. And I've been teaching since 2000 and taught probably over 450 students on how to groom dogs as a career.
Yes, excellent. Excellent. Thank you so much, folks. Mm-hmm. Any final thoughts? Otherwise, we'll say goodbye. We'll show our contact information. If you have other topics you'd like us to cover, please let me know. I've already lined up November. It's going to be very exciting as well. But if you've got a special story, you've got a special skill, you've got a special dog mom or dog dad story, please let us know. And if there's some more grooming topics you want to know, maybe Cindy will be kind enough to come back for our Dear It Yourself series. That's really helpful to you and for the groomer. Again, Barb Emmet, thanks for staying with us for this hour. Thanks, Cindy. We'll put our contact information up and have a great month. We'll see you again next month. Bye-bye.
Dog is Family on Berks Community Television is underwritten by Answers Pet Food.